What's good, everyone? Nightcage here. All right, man, here we go. Infernal Legion Chronicles, part 4. Okay, so I have the great host configurations here. I'm not going to go through these right now because I'm going to come back and go through each great host configuration individually as I start painting the troops and putting them together. For right now, it suffices to say that the Legion has 8 great hosts, 8 great companies, right? And there's an Infernal Lord, which I've already introduced to you guys. There's an Infernal Lord and a Lord of Slaughter in charge of each one. So I'm going to thumb through those. So I have the first and second great hosts here, right? They all have a different configuration. We're going to talk about them individually later. So I'm going to come back to them. And then, of course, we have the Legion Battle Fleet, the Devourer of Stars, Angron's Space Hulk. And then what is made up of the Legion's battle fleet. So we have all of that as well. And I'll say this about this particular part. When we do our campaigns, we collectively as a club have decided that when we travel from location to location, we're gonna do a battle fleet gothic mission in between ground assault missions. And then we'll send the troops down to the ground based on the results of the battle fleet gothic mission. So we're going to embed Battlefleet Gothic in our travel plan for our campaigns from here on out. So I'm gonna go ahead and just keep on pushing forward. Okay, then we have the Legion Special Rules. The Legion Special Rules is really, really what I wanna talk about in this book, in this video, in part 4. And then in the next video, we'll talk about the Legion as a whole, right? All of the individual units within the Legion we'll get into. And then I'll come back to the special characters and then we'll get into formations and stuff like that. So, okay. So now let me lay out the Legion for you. Before we talk about these special rules really, really quickly, let me lay it out. So, because I want you guys to understand the premise of the Legion. So this Legion is a fleet-based Legion. Okay. Okay, here we go. All right, so the Infernal Legion is a fleet-based legion. That means that the Infernal Legion is built around its battle fleet. It is a planetary assault legion. So one of the things that I wanted to do with designing this legion is coming up with 2 things that is going to highlight this legion, that's going to make it different from anything else that you will face. And so one of the questions that I wanted to, that I had to ask myself is, okay, for my Legion, how do I want this Legion, like what is going to be the theme of this Legion, right? And pretty much if you look across Warhammer 40,000, just about every race that you run into in some way, shape, or form has its own theme. But one of the things that I found out about Chaos, and I've been playing Chaos since the 90s, one of the things that I found about Chaos that has always bugged me is that it has always been, except for version 3.5, it has always been so generic. And I wanted to get away from that. So one of the things that I wanted to do, and this book, the Traitor Legion's book, has kind of helped, it really has helped resolve part of this issue. And so kudos to Games Workshop for releasing this book, because I'm gonna use it as a supplement for my codex as well. One of the things that I needed to do with my Legion that I wanted to do is stay true to the Legion as it was prior to going into the war, right? So in going back and looking at the history, this was a question that I had to try and answer. And that question was, what happened to the World Eaters after the Heresy ended and after they went into the war, right? As a Legion, right? So if we think about this from this perspective, as a Legion, what happened to the World Eaters? Well, one of the things that we know is once the traitors side lost the Heresy, not just the World Eaters, but the Death Guard, the Emperor's Children, the Night Lords, the Iron Warriors, everybody, once they lost and went into the warp, they went into the warp intact with their fleets, right? They didn't stop and say, you know what, we're not with the Imperium anymore. We're going to turn all of our stuff in. We're going to check all of our stuff in, and we're going to go into the warp, and we're somehow going to create new stuff. That's not what happened. They went into the warp as they were, right? Now, although their armor might have gotten corrupted and it changed colors, their war gear didn't change. So one of the first things that I wanted to do, the World Eaters were known as the Bloody 13. So it was a fleet-based legion specializing in planetary assaults and specializing in ship-to-ship boarding actions. And I didn't want to lose that essence. So in creating the special rules for the Infernal Legion, I wanted the Lords of Slaughter to maintain that essence of what the Legion was like. So the Triad, Kosalax, Hans Corrin, and Shalik the Elite, the two Triad who founded the Lords of Slaughter cadre for the command structure for the Legion, they put things in place so that the Legion maintained its essence. So the Legion is still a fleet-based Legion, but then the question was, how do you bring that across in the game? Like, when you're playing against me, how does my army make you feel like you are playing against an army that is largely based on a battle fleet, right? On its fleet delivery system, for example. So I needed to come up with special rules that gave you a sort of indication that you're not just dealing with the troops on the ground, you're also dealing with the supporting fleet in orbit, and you're dealing with supporting aircraft, of course. So this needed to be an army that is largely, it's marine element anyway, that is largely based around the fleet element, which is where the special rules came from, right? So I'm going to get into their special rules really, really quickly. One of the first special rules that they have is called the Blood God's Sacred Number of 8 right here, okay? So basically any unit with this sacred number, with Korn's sacred number, can reroll failed charge ranges. So that's one of their special rules. But the big ones that I wanted to talk about here is Rain of Blood, the Infernal Fleet, and the Drop Pod Assault. So these are the three special rules. Everything else is primarily the same. Mark of Korn, Chosen of Angron, Demon of Korn, Blood for the Blood God, Kornate Chain Axes. All of that stuff is stuff that you guys already know about from the regular game. But what's different about this Legion that really, really makes it unique is the Rain of Blood special rule. Like, this is a really unique one. So all models with the Mark of Korn may take Drop Pods, Dreadclaws, Rhinos, Storm Eagles, all Land Raider variants, Mastodon transports as dedicated transports. Each unit that arrives via Deep Strike, Drop Pod, or Dreadclaw, roll a D6. On a 1 or 2, all units that arrive may assault in the turn that they arrive. So this right here is one of the special rules that we play tested for probably 6 months. We kept play testing this particular rule over and over again, the Rain of Blood special rule. One of the things that we wanted was we wanted to show how the fleet specializes in drop assault. And so the question was, okay, well, how does that come across? Well, one of the things that we quickly realized that we needed to do was because the World Eaters Legion, before going into the warp as a Legion, they use drop pods all the time. As a matter of fact, if you look in the Betrayal book, it talks a great deal about how effective the World Eaters were with their drop assault tactics. So the question was, okay, how do we create a delivery system for this army that makes the Infernal Legion feel like a fleet-based Legion? So the idea was to create rules for them that gives them something unique. So the Infernal Legion can take drop pods. They kept their drop pods from the Great Crusades and the Heresy. They didn't turn them in. So the Infernal Legion has drop pods, not just Dreadclaws, but they have drop pods. And so the Infernal Legion, what makes them unique is when they arrive via drop pod, I roll a D6. And on a roll of a 1 or a 2, that squad can come out of its drop pod and assault you the turn that it arrives. Now, we play tested this over and over and over again because this was one of the rules that I really liked. To have a unit, have a squad be able to arrive from a drop pod and not be a sitting duck, which makes the drop pods useless. We really, really put this into action and we play tested it against everything. We threw everything at it to try to see if it would break the game, and it absolutely made the game exciting. And so all of us in the campaign's gamer club, myself, Andrew, Kate, Plaguewin, and Jerome, all of us, we really, really play tested this over and over again, and we absolutely loved it. So Rain of Blood is one of the special rules. The other thing also that Rain of Blood did that makes it unique is making Land Raiders dedicated transports instead of them taking a heavy support slot, which probably doesn't mean anything now with you being able to play Unbound and everything. It probably doesn't mean anything now, but we just thought that it sounded cool, so we decided to keep it. The other special rule that the Legion has for its planetary assaults is called the Infernal Fleet. Okay. Thunderhawk gunships, Mastodons, Thunderhawk transports are dedicated transports instead of Lords of War. The Chosen of Angron Infernal Fleet is a fleet-based legion that specializes in deep strike and planetary assaults. So, this was another thing that we wanted to do. If I want to have 2 or 3 or 4 Thunderhawks fly my troops in, I don't need a Thunderhawk counting as a Lord of War and preventing me from being able to bring in 3 Thunderhawks if we want to play one, if we want to play it that way. And one of the things that we had in mind was Plaguewin and I doing a campaign, the Infernal Legion against the Death Guard, right? And having our troops being carried in by Thunderhawk gunships. And so we bought 4 Thunderhawk gunships. I know we are crazy, crazy, crazy. We bought 4 Thunderhawk gunships. Plaguewin has 2 and I have 2. And Andrew has the Eldar Vampire, the really big one. So we all made the decision that, well, what if we want to just play with flyers and have these really huge orbital ships, these Thunderhawks fly down from the orbital battle barge and have them fly down to the surface and have this epic battle in the air, or deliver our troops to the ground. And them having them counting as a Lord of War was a problem for me because it meant, well, Angron is a Lord of War. So if I take Angron, I can't take a Thunderhawk, and that's stupid. So the Infernal Fleet special rule was put in place to deal with that situation. To remove that. Now, there's one other thing that the Infernal Fleet special rule does do. And this is only for the Lords of Slaughter. It gives them Orbital Strike. So, the Orbital Strike rules, of course, are the same as it is in the normal rules. But the Orbital Strike rule gives only the Lords of Slaughter. It gives the Lords of Slaughter Orbital Strike. And that rule was put in place to show the command structure. That the Lords of Slaughter are constantly in contact with Fleet Command. So you get the feeling that you're not just playing against a Chaos Warband on the ground who can't communicate with anybody because they're not intelligent enough. So the idea was to differentiate a Chaos Lord from a Lord of Slaughter. That Lord of Slaughter needed to be unique. So what we decided to do was give the Lords of Slaughter, all of them, the Lords of Slaughter can communicate directly with Fleet Command. So they can call in airstrikes. They can call in air support. They have access to Thunderhawk gunships. So it really feels like you're fighting against a fleet, and that really makes this army unique. And that was the whole idea. And the last special rule that we're going to talk about today is the Drop Pod Assault. Infernal Legion is known for its ability to rain down on planets with drop pods numbering in the thousands. They basically blanket a planet with drop pods. They just unload. Okay, in a case where the Infernal Legion deploys its drop pods, roll a single d6. And here it is, and this is what we're talking about. On a 1 or 2, the drop pods arrive in the same turn. Okay, so basically, that rule was actually taken from the Blood Angels. The Blood Angels have a formation that allows them, when you roll for your reserves, for that entire formation to arrive at one time. So this is the same rule. It's just the same rule with a different title. So for the Legion, we decided that would definitely make the Legion feel like a Legion. If it makes it feel like the Lord of Slaughter is on his battle barge and he's decided he's going to assault this planet. He's looking down on his planet. He gets his strike force together. They all load up in the drop pods and they unleash the drop pods and they all just rain down on this planet. And when they arrive, they just wreak havoc. So in order to make the Legion unique, let me wrap it up. So these things were put in place. So first, the drop pod assault special rule allows me at the beginning of the game to roll a d6. On a 1 or a 2, all Legion drop pods arrive at the same time. On a 3 through 6, you use the standard drop pod rules per the rule book. No harm, no foul. Okay, then of course we have the Infernal Fleet special rule, which gives the Lords of Slaughter orbital strike. Okay, and allows the Legion to take Thunderhawk gunships as dedicated transports instead of Lords of War. So in the event that I want to play Angron, who is a Lord of War, or I want to play one of the Cauldron Lords, who are also Lords of War, then I can play them and play my Thunderhawks all at the same time. And then the last thing is the Reign of Blood, which is the special rule which indicates what squads can do once the drop pods arrive. Right, and that is on a 1 or 2 they can assault the turn they arrive, and on a 3 through 6 they act as normal. And that's pretty much it. That's in a nutshell, that's it. Other than that, the Legion is no different than any other Legion. But I think that with those three special rules, it really, really does give the Legion a fleet-based feel, which is what we were looking for. Okay, so I'm going to end it right here because I have gone on for a long time. Thank you guys for listening. Don't forget, comment, like, and subscribe. Definitely give me your thoughts, man. And when you get a chance to see the Infernal Legion in action, you'll understand what I'm saying. It is really exciting. It is a really fun Legion to play now because, I mean, there is a lot of unexpected things that can happen. Like, I'm playing against Andrew's Eldar, for example. I went an entire game. Drop pods did not come in because I was just rolling horribly. The drop pods did not get a chance to use the drop pod assault special rule because I kept rolling fives and sixes. So my drop pods were sporadically coming in and he was targeting my troops. And then I wasn't able to get my Rain of Blood off, so the troops could not assault when they come in. So I would try to put them in a position where they're close enough to his units to get the assault when they come out. And that was failing. And then he was turning his guns on me and he just waxed. The Legion just got waxed, but it still was fun. I mean, there's an unknown element there, but it was still fun to play with. It just made the army really unique and really fun, so we had a lot of fun playing. So I'm gonna stop here. In the next video, part 5, we are going to get into all of the troop elements and the HQ elements and the elites and fast attacks and special heavy support and all of that kind of stuff. So you guys get to see what the codex actually looks like.